Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for being here. I'm Skip Rutherford, Dean of the University of Arkansas Clinton School of Public Service. And I appreciate you being here to welcome Chelsea Clinton back to Arkansas. You know, she's also delivering the baccalaureate address this evening at Little Rock Central High School. Some of you didn't know that. Good. I'm glad I told you. Where I think if some guy from Arkansas had not been elected president, she would have likely gone to high school. Adding to that, Joyce Akubin, who works with Chelsea and who is back home with her, did go to school there and was president of the Central Student Body. So I want to thank the Clinton Foundation, Stephanie Street, Lena Moore, Yana Janelle Scott, and others for partnering with us on this event. We appreciate that. I want to thank Nikolai DePippa of the Clinton School for his great organizational work, no one better. And I want to thank all the many volunteers who have helped make this possible. When the program ends, Stephanie will be making some closing remarks and the book signing will follow. I also want to thank Anna Kimmel, Director of Education for the Arkansas Rep. Let's hear it for the Rep. We need the Rep in Arkansas. In a minute, you're in for a special treat. Students from the Rep Summer Program will be reading from Chelsea's book. After the reading, there will be a moderated discussion between Chelsea and the New York Times bestselling author of The Light We Lost, Jill Santopolo, who, when she is not writing or editing or speaking herself, works with the Fine Arts Writing Program for Children and Young Adults at the New School in New York City. Her new book, More Than Words, will be released next year. Before welcoming students from the Arkansas Rep, may I please ask that you silence your cell phones, and in the spirit of public service, please don't forget to vote Tuesday. Ladies and gentlemen, a reading from Chelsea Clinton's She Persisted Around the World.
It's not always easy being a girl anywhere in the world.
There are countries where it's hard for girls to go to school and where women need their husband's permission to get a passport or even to leave the house.
And all over the world, girls are more likely to be told to be quiet, to sit down, to have smaller dreams.
Don't listen to those voices.
These 13 women from across the world didn't. They persisted.
At the time Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz was growing up in Mexico, most girls did not go to school. After reading and studying on her own, Juana Inés asked her family if she could disguise herself as a boy so she could go to university. They said no. She persisted, finding tutors who didn't mind teaching a girl, and then became a nun, in part so that she could focus on her studies and her writing. Sor Juana Inés's poems and plays are still celebrated today, and her Respuesta a Sor Filotea de la Cruz was the first published argument for a woman's right to education in the Americas.
I don't study to know more, but to ignore less.
Although Caroline Herschel's mother didn't think girls should be educated, her father taught her alongside her brothers. But after typhus left Caroline permanently stunted at just over 4 feet tall, both parents thought her only future was to be a servant. She persisted, leaving her native Germany to live in England with her brother William, who supported her efforts to further educate herself, including in math and astronomy. Together, they studied the night sky, and on her own, Caroline became the first woman to discover a comet. Today, several of the comets she found bear her name.
However long we live, life is short, so I work.
When Kate Sheppard began traveling throughout New Zealand, saying that women deserved voting rights, many men believed that women should avoid meddling in masculine concerns. When Kate first tried to get Parliament to give women the right to vote, they didn't listen, even though she presented them many petitions that thousands of women had signed. Still, she persisted. And in 1893, New Zealand became the first country to grant all women, including indigenous Maori women, the right to vote.
We are tired of having a sphere doled out to us and of being told that anything outside of that sphere is unwomanly. We must be ourselves at all risks.
Growing up in Poland, Marie Curie knew that because she was a girl, she would have to leave her country to go to college. She persisted, moving to France to pursue her dream of being a scientist. Her work in radioactivity, the way that some materials give off energy, led to her becoming the first woman awarded a Nobel Prize in physics. A few years later, she discovered two new elements, one of which she named polonium after her home country. For that work, she won her second Nobel Prize in chemistry. She was the first person in the world, man or woman, to receive two Nobel Prizes.
Nothing in life is to be feared. It is only to be understood.
When Viola Desmond was on a business trip, her car broke down. So she decided to go to the movies while she waited for it to be fixed. But Viola didn't know that in the town she was visiting, only white Canadians were allowed to sit on the movie theater's main floor. When Viola was asked to leave, she persisted in saying that it was her right to sit wherever she wanted. Viola was arrested and spent the night in jail. Her decision to fight the charge against her helped start the modern civil rights movement in Canada.
I didn't realize a thing like this could happen in Nova Scotia or any other part of Canada.
While working in India as a young doctor focused on caring for women, Mary Verghese was in a terrible car accident and lost the use of her legs. Rather than quit medicine, she persisted and shifted her work to the kind of care she could give patients from her wheelchair just as well as anyone could from standing up. She focused on rehabilitation, working with people who had also lost the use of their legs or faced other challenges after accidents or illness. Mary founded the first functional rehabilitation center in India. It still helps patients today.
At first, the thread seems so tangled and broken, but I'm beginning to think that life may have a pattern after all.
After going to law school, Aisha Rateb hoped to become a judge in Egypt. But the then prime minister told Aisha that she couldn't because a female judge would be against the traditions of society. She persisted in doing important legal work, helping to write a new constitution for Egypt, crafting new rules to protect women and people with disabilities, and serving as Egypt's first female ambassador. More than 50 years after Aisha was told no, the first woman was appointed to Egypt's highest court, thanks in part to Aisha.
When I proposed changing the law before, the fanatics staged demonstrations against me. We will continue to fight for reform.
As the first woman in East and Central Africa to earn a doctorate degree and become a professor at the University of Nairobi, Wangari Maathai made two of her dreams come true. Still, she wanted to do more. Horrified by how many trees had been cut down across Kenya, Wangari started to plant trees. She persisted in getting family, friends, students, and even strangers to help plant more trees and to respect the environment. She also worked hard to protect and defend the rights of everyone in Kenya. Wangari was the first African woman awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Her legacy includes the more than 50 million trees her Greenbelt movement has planted.
I don't really know why I care so much. I just have something inside me that tells me that there's a problem and I've got to do something about it.
As a little girl in the United Kingdom, Joanne Rowling knew she wanted to be a writer. After the university, she spent years of creating the Harry Potter world, while also working full-time. Even though many publishers rejected her first book, she persisted. The publisher she finally found worried that boy readers might not want to read a book featuring a boy wizard written by a woman, and asked Joanne to publish as J.K. It sounded less female. Today, the Harry Potter series is the best-selling book series in history, with more than 400 million books in print in 80 languages. And its author is famous as the woman who brought more magic into the world.
We do not need magic to transform our world. We carry all the power we need inside ourselves already.
When Sidleji Sissi Lima d'Amor was young, it was against the law for girls to play soccer in Brazil. But Sissi wanted to play, even if she got in trouble. So she persisted, first in secret, turning other toys into soccer balls and practicing whenever she could. Eventually, Sissi's parents got her a soccer ball. When she was 14, 2 years after Brazil made it legal for girls to play soccer, Sissi started playing professionally and then joined the first Brazilian women's national soccer team. At the height of her career, Sissi was called the Queen of Brazilian football, and today is credited with inspiring a generation of Brazilian girls to be unafraid to take the field.
One of our goals is that people in society will accept that girls play soccer.
Civil war erupted in Liberia when Leymah Gbowee had just finished high school. Living through the war inspired Leymah to become a trauma counselor to help other children affected by conflict. When civil war broke out again years later, Leymah knew she didn't want to simply live through it this time or help the victims afterward. She wanted to help end it. She persisted, bringing together thousands of Liberian Christian and Muslim women to peacefully protest the violence. Their efforts helped end the war and led to safe, free elections in which Liberia elected its first woman president. For her work, Leymah was awarded a Nobel Peace Prize.
The more I did, the more I could do, the more I wanted to do, the more I saw needed to be done.
When she was growing up in China, Yuan Yuan Tan's father did not want his daughter to take ballet. She persisted in convincing him that being a dancer was her destiny. Finally, her father said that he would decide Yuan Yuan's fate with a coin toss. If the coin landed on heads, she could pursue ballet. If the coin landed on tails, she couldn't. Yuan Yuan won the coin toss. She went on to become among the most famous Chinese ballerinas of all time, winning many awards, dancing around the world, and becoming the youngest principal dancer ever at the San Francisco Ballet, where she still performs today.
When I watch other dancers do the same role as I do, I don't try to be anyone else.
When Malala Yousafzai was 11, she began writing about how much she wanted to get an education, even though some people in her native Pakistan thought girls shouldn't go to school. Malala was threatened many times, but she persisted in writing about her dreams for herself and girls everywhere. When Malala was 15, a man boarded her school bus and shot her, targeting her because of her courage in standing up for girls' right to go to school. Even after she was hurt, Malala didn't give up. She is the youngest ever Nobel Peace Prize winner and still works hard in the hope that one day every child will be able to go to school, all while she herself is still in school.
One child, one teacher, one book, and one pen can change the world.
So, speak up.
Rise up.
Dream big.
These women did that and more.
They persisted. And so should you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Before we begin this part of the program, I think we just have to express our gratitude again for the just extraordinary performance we just saw. I mean, I have been really lucky to have heard different people read my books across the country and have had people send me videos of people reading my books around the world. And I just have never seen or experienced anything like that. It just was magical and powerful. And thank you all so much. So please give the Arkansas Repertory Theatre education program and its stellar actresses and readers another round of applause. I want to thank Skip for his generous introduction of Jill and me, and Stephanie, and everyone at the Clinton Library and Presidential Center who helped make today possible. I know that events like this are always real team efforts, so although we don't have time to thank everyone by name, I hope you know how grateful we really are for all of the work that you've put into kind of bringing us here today to talk about She Persisted Around the World and why I think it is so important that we give literal platforms to girls to tell their stories. And I think one of the ways we do that is by sharing stories of remarkable women who've done remarkable things through the combination of their talents and their persistence. So thank you all for being here, and now I'll turn it over to Jill to guide us forward.
All right, thank you everyone for coming. Wow, look at this group. All right, so we're here in Little Rock, where you grew up. And we're talking about books that might inspire young readers.
And I was wondering if we could start by talking about any books that you might have read when you were growing up here that inspired you or that you still think about today.
Well, I think my first grade teacher might be here, Mrs. Mitchell, who, oh yes, she is. Hi, Mrs. Mitchell. So I learned how to read chapter books with Mrs. Mitchell, and I also learned how to read magazines. And the reason that second part was important is because I was really lucky at both, I went to two different elementary schools. I went to Forest Park where I had Mrs. Mitchell, and then I went to Booker, which isn't too far from here. And in both of the libraries, there were old copies of National Geographic magazine. So I was thinking about this week because National Geographic announced they were no longer gonna wrap their magazines in plastic to try to help eliminate plastic waste, particularly given that we have, you know, hundreds of millions, probably billions of pounds of plastic waste every year, and much of that goes into the oceans. And so I have these vivid memories of reading old copies of National Geographic and just being transported literally around the world and throughout time and space. And I'm so thankful that Mrs. Mitchell helped kind of give me that portal kind of into the world and to help me fuel my imagination. And none of that would have been possible without words. So although we have talked a lot about books, understandably, I just need to give a shout out to National Geographic and how important those magazines were to me as a kid.
So I think you might have just answered my second question, which was, were there any women in your childhood growing up here who you found as inspirational or who helped you develop into the person that you've become?
I'm really lucky in that I've always had strong and supportive, encouraging women in my life. You know, from my grandmothers, both of whom lived in Arkansas when I was growing up, to my mom, I'm always happy to hear a shout out for my mom, the women who helped take care of me. I have one of my nannies is here, so it's really such a thrill for me to see her, and I hope that she, like Mrs. Mitchell, is proud of the person I'm still trying to become. And so really, I couldn't be more thankful for the community that my parents brought me into and then helped create for me. And I just was really lucky to always have extraordinary teachers from preschool, kindergarten, first grade, kind of all the way through until I left. And I talk about Mrs. Mitchell a lot because she was hugely important to me. And I just hope that my children are lucky enough to have teachers as good as Mrs. Mitchell and so many of the teachers I had here.
It's fantastic. So after you, you know, left Little Rock, grew up, you've been doing a lot of things. You work at the Clinton Foundation, you teach, you've written books on public health governance, and also now your fourth book was just announced that for children that's coming out in September. And I was wondering what it is about children's books that keeps you writing in that sphere.
Well, for picture books, I quote Sally Ride in the first She Persisted, you know, it's hard to imagine what we can't see. And I think that's true for all of us. And one of my hopes for She Persisted and She Persisted Around the World is that it helps little girls imagine themselves as anything. And that it helps little boys imagine little girls as anything. And so I'm so thankful that She Persisted resonated and that then provided me the opportunity to write She Persisted Around the World. And I hope to have even more chances to continue to share, elevate, and amplify stories of women who have inspired me in the hopes that they will inspire young readers or readers of any age, but particularly to help close the imagination gap for girls and boys alike. Because we know that before kids start school, girls and boys have equally diverse and dynamic ambitions. And they want to be CEOs, even if they may not know what that is at three or four. They know that it's something kind of big and important. It's a leadership role. You know, they want to be award-winning athletes or artists. They want to be writers. They want to be teachers, they want to be firefighters, they want to be police officers, you know, they want to be mayors, they want to be governors, they want to be president, they want to be astronauts, right? They want to do all of the same sorts of remarkable things. And by third grade, there's a massive difference where girls no longer largely see themselves in those kind of leadership roles or those award-winning roles. And that to me is shameful and unacceptable because I want everyone to be able to feel connected and supported in their potential and in their dreams kind of from the earliest ages onward. And I think the stories we tell our children are profoundly important in trying to help make that happen. So I'm gonna keep doing my kind of small part to share stories that mean something to me, but also to help kind of shift the imagination gap, not only kind of for individual readers, but really for like our youngest children broadly.
So to follow up on that, you know, the first She Persisted came out about a year ago, and She Persisted Around the World came out a couple of months ago. Have there been reactions from children or from parents on the road as you've been traveling around talking about these books that have either surprised you or that you found particularly interesting or exciting to hear?
Oh, absolutely. In She Persisted, the first book, all 13 of the women whose stories I include, I remember when I first kind of learned about them, or I remember kind of being inspired by their stories for as long as I can remember. So I remember my mom telling me the story of Helen Keller. I remember kind of looking up to Sally Ride in elementary school because I had dreams of going into space. I remember watching Flojo break the world records in the 1988 Olympics. I remember reading Nellie Bly in college. I remember watching old movies of Maria Tallchief dance. And then most recently, I remember learning about Virginia Apgar when I was pregnant and learning about the Apgar score. And I couldn't believe that I didn't know kind of who this woman was, this woman who created something decades ago that still is the standard test everywhere around the world to assess a newborn baby's health. And what I have been so I'm very amused by the children I meet who, I can't believe that FloJo's records from 1988 still stand, and that was so long ago. Like, they can't believe that I remember watching her. But I'm also very kind of moved to hear what stories resonate and why, either with parents or teachers who sometimes come to my events or really particularly from young readers. I find many children have the same reaction that my daughter had when reading She Persisted Around the World for the first time, where she couldn't believe it was illegal for girls to play soccer. Because my daughter's 3.5, so the only thing that she has real like experience with at this point is playing soccer, of the other kind of stories in the book. And so many kids, since soccer is the most popular kid sport across the country, can't believe that it was illegal. And it wasn't illegal that long ago. It was illegal for girls to play soccer until 1979, right? So not that long ago. And I love the few occasions where kids have come dressed up as their favorite characters to my book events. That gives me such joy. But I will say, Jill, that the performance that we just watched, I think, is my favorite moment thus far of my She Persisted Around the World book tour. So.
So you were talking a little bit about the way you chose the women in She Persisted in the first one, and that they were all women who had inspired you. Was there a different thought process going into the second one? And you know, could you talk a little bit about maybe the differences between the two, or how you sort of came up with the women in She Persisted Around the World?
Well, for She Persisted Around the World, there were some women I knew that I wanted to include. I've looked up to Wangari Maathai for 30 years. I mean, the issue that I felt most connected to when I was growing up in Arkansas kind of was global warming and climate change. And I remember learning about this remarkable woman who was planting trees and had organized a veritable army of tree planters across across Kenya and then across East Africa broadly. And so when I was thinking about She Persisted Around the World, I thought, oh, like I know that I want to include Wangari Maathai. And then I realized pretty quickly there are so many more stories that I don't know. And so I reached out to friends and acquaintances who had grown up in other countries or lived and worked in other countries. And I'm really thankful that Jill did the same, like asking kind of her fellow editors across kind of the big Penguin Random House family. And we got sent so many suggestions. And it was then such a fun process for me because I then got to learn about all of these remarkable women's stories I didn't know, and I'm so thankful that I know now. And then similar to the first book, you know, I wanted to feel a strong connection to each of the stories because I think that authenticity comes through the writing. And I also wanted a diversity of women from different countries who had lived at different times, who had achieved kind of important things in different fields, so that hopefully it would again be not only kind of individual stories that I hope resonate with readers, but kind of the totality of like look what women have done, and so then just think about what we could do.
Yeah. So you were just talking about how there's a large diversity of women in this book, and in both books actually, and you know, some of them, because they were from a long time ago, are no longer alive, and some of them are here and can read this book. Did writing about people who were still around and could read what you wrote about them change how you thought about it or feel any different than writing about people further back in history?
No, I think I feel the same level of responsibility. Though we reached out to everyone who was living to ensure that what we were saying was not only accurate, but resonated with them. And I'm thankful that kind of everyone, you know, said yes. And we also reached out to kind of the institutions associated with kind of the women's legacies in the cases where organizations do exist to continue their work, even if kind of the women themselves are no longer living. Like Wangari Maathai, sadly, is no longer living, but her Greenbelt movement kind of still persists in its environmental justice work and in planting trees. You know, so we talked to her daughter, who's the head of that organization, Wangari. We spoke to the Margaret Chase Smith Library. So Margaret Chase Smith, who was the first woman to be both a congresswoman and a senator from Maine, who I think is actually one of the really unrecognized important figures in kind of the second half of the 20th century in our country. She helped save the space program when it looked like it was going to be cut for budgetary reasons. And so, as I kind of quote in the book, it was said that we never would have put a man on the moon without Margaret. And she fought very hard for equal rights for women in government service broadly, including in the military, far before it was a kind of expected thing to do. She helped make the rose our national flower. She wore a red rose every day for decades, literally, until I think she just wore down her colleagues. So kind of in lots of areas, she had a real impact. So we reached out to the Margaret Chase Smith Library. So yes, like whenever we could, we reached out either to people themselves or to the organizations that steward their legacies. Because I think it's important that kind of the words and also the pictures, you know, feel right to the women whose legacies and stories we're sharing and celebrating.
Yeah, I loved when we saw the picture that Sissi took, where she had found the book and she was so excited. You know, it was in the bookstore and whatever.
Yes. Sissi, who now runs soccer camps for little kids, particularly little girls. I also love that she's kind of continuing to share her love of soccer in a very real way.
So after you write the text, it gets sent to Alexandra Boyger, the artist. What's it like for you when you see her sketches for the first time or see the finished art for the first time?
I've loved working with Alexandra. She is the person that I'd hope to work with. We fell in love with her work through the Tallulah Ballerina series. I don't know if any of you know those books. And I just thought that she had the right kind of mix of earnestness, but also softness. I mean, I wanted these women's stories to be told in picture, you know, not only respectfully and forcefully, but also in a way that would be accessible to kids so they could imagine themselves, you know, as doing what these women have done. And so just being able to work with Alexandra has been a tremendous gift. And, you know, Jill, when you ask, like, what are my first thoughts, I'm always in awe of her talent. I have no visual artistic talent at all. Like, I mean, I went to, like, every possible arts camp at the Arkansas Arts Center, and I didn't have, I mean, none of it, right? I mean, like, I couldn't draw, I couldn't etch, I couldn't paint, I couldn't pot, is that the verb, pottery, whatever.
Throw pots.
Exactly, sculpt, see, exactly. I just, so I think I'm in awe, not only of her talent, but I also, if I'm totally candid, I'm in awe because I have not even, like, an iota of that talent. But she's such a, just a generous, kind of thoughtful and clearly brilliant person, and it's a joy to work with her.
So did you ever, I've never asked you this, so I'm now curious in front of all these people. Do you ever have pictures in your head of what you think it might look like, or you just give her the text and it just...
No, I mean, I will think about, it takes a long time to write three sentences. Like, it takes a very long time to try to distill down, like, why I think these women's stories are important into three sentences. So I obsess about words, and I obsess about, like, whether it should be one sentence or broken into two shorter sentences. And I obsess about kind of the cadence of those words. And I trust Alexandra completely on the art.
I think the two of you make a fantastic team on these books. So if there's one thing that you think that families, or that you hope that families will take away from reading these books together, what would that one thing be?
Well, I think the answer to that is as varied as every family or child who would read the book. Right? I mean, I would hope that it would touch and inspire, you know, any family or young reader reading the book, and then I would want the readers to understand kind of why persistence is such an integral part of not only kind of achieving but really of life. But kind of what that would mean or how they would think about it or what person's story kind of meant the most to them, I would leave it up to the youngest readers to determine and to share with kind of their parents or their grandparents or whomever they might be reading the books with.
All right, so we're about to turn this over to audience Q&A, but before that, since there are so many projects that you work on at once, I wanted to give you a chance to just tell everyone about something else that you're working on that you're excited about. Anything.
Well, as Jill mentioned, I teach at the Mammon School of Public Health at Columbia. And I just am starting a new effort on trying to help all the different people and organizations that are working on women's health around the world to better learn from each other. So kind of what's really working in rural settings, whether it's like here in the United States or in Latin America or in Sub-Saharan Africa or in Europe. And I just have been so impressed by kind of all the people that I've gotten to meet and really humbled by the people that I'm going to get to work with. And so I'm really excited about that. And I also am really excited about our continued work at the Clinton Foundation around Too Small to Fail to try to help every kind of person who is in a very young person's life, so parents, grandparents, older siblings, caregivers, to understand why it's so important to read, sing, and talk to our kids, because 80% of our brains are built by the time we're three. And we recently have expanded our partnerships with the Coin Laundry Association of America, so we're going from 5,000 laundromats to now 8,000 laundromats, where there'll be prompts to talk about kind of laundry, that like wash time can be talk time. And I'm excited because this year we'll cross the 1 million bookmark for books that we've been able to give away.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Great two things. So I think now we're going to turn it over to all of you. And from what I was told, there are going to be three microphones in three of these aisles. And we'll just go one, two, three, and back again, which I think might be the easiest way to make this work.
And I hope that kids will ask questions, although I'm thrilled to see the adults standing up too, but I hope that kids will ask questions.
Hello, thank you for being here today. The early 90s, well, throughout the 90s, were a very unfair time for you. There was a lot of bashing in the media and things like that, yet you persisted. Thank you. What were some of the lessons? What were some of the lessons that you learned, and what were some of the advice that your parents gave you, and what advice do you have for young girls who may be treated unfairly and frankly are bullied?
Well, thank you for what you said, and thank you for your question. I think about this a lot, actually, because of the epidemic of bullying, cyberbullying, and kind of in real life bullying that we are confronting right now. Like, not only in schools, but really kind of wherever kids spend time. So to answer your question first about me, and then I'll share some thoughts about kind of what I think all adults really need to be doing in this moment to help support and protect our kids and help our kids understand how best to support and protect each other. You know, for me, I think in some ways, I actually was lucky because the things that were being said about me were so outrageous. And I was like a 12-year-old girl, and there were men, you know, three or four times my age saying like awful, awful things about me. And the reason I say that I was lucky that it was so outrageous is because then I didn't have any like ambivalence about that. I thought like, that's just crazy. Like, why are these grown men attacking me? Like, I'm in seventh grade. Like, I'm just trying to go to school and like hang out with my friends and like, you know, like figure out how to not get cut from the volleyball team. Like, you know, I mean, like, that's what I was worried about. So I think that that was actually really good for me, because it wasn't subtle. And I think one of the challenges we have now is we have a lot of subtle and unsubtle bullying, right? So we have a lot of just vicious attacks on whole groups of people and also on individuals. And we have a lot of more kind of subtle bullying, I think, particularly around girls and girls' appearances on an relative basis to other girls. And so I think a few things. I think one, we have to bring it out into the open, because I think that kind of bullying kind of thrives in darkness. And so creating spaces where our children or other young people in our lives, you know, my husband and I talk about this a lot because we have 20 nieces and nephews, like how, if our nieces and nephews aren't comfortable talking to their parents, how can we establish a trusted relationship so they feel like they can come talk to us? And have already spoken to kind of, you know, our my in-laws, like about how we hope our children can have that same relationship with them. So I think that's one. You know, two, we have a lot of research now that says like walking through scenarios with our children actually is really helpful. Like, if someone says this to you, like, practice what you would say back. And if you see someone say that to someone else, like, practice how you be an ally, right? Because allyship is action, right? It's not sufficient to be kind of only words or a feeling. So I think, you know, creating trusted space, kind of talking about bullying, hopefully even before it happens. The scenarios, I think, are important, not only so children and young people feel then almost instinctively like they know how to respond to bullying, but also so they know when to ask for help, right? Because we do want, kind of going back to the trusted relationships, we do want young people to handle it on their own when they can, because I think that helps teach resilience, but to never be vulnerable, right? And so to also know like when to come to a parent or an aunt or a teacher to ask for help. But I think first we have to bring it out into the open, because I think for too long we've just sort of had this approach that like if we ignore it, it's gonna go away. And it just has been proven to not be the case. So I think we have to switch strategies and not ignore it and look at face on, so our kids know they're not alone. And there are a lot more of us who do believe in kindness and love and respect. And we need to start demonstrating that in every way we can.
a question in the middle?
I'm scared.
It's okay, take your time.
Why did you not add your mother in this book?
So my mother, does make an appearance in the first book. She's in the opening gallery spread. So if you open the first book, there are portraits of the 13 women, you know, starting with Harriet Tubman, the 13 women in the book, and then a portrait of my mom. I didn't want the book to be only about my mom, and I worried if I included my mom, it might become that. But I also knew that I couldn't write a book about persistence and women who inspired me if I didn't ensure that she was there somehow. So her portrait is there, and certainly her story inspires me every day.
Are there any questions over?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Back there.
What do you miss most about living in Arkansas?
Oh, that's an easy one. I miss most my friends who live here. That's easy. The people, I miss the people that I love who are still here.
Oh. How did you find the research for all the people's names in your book?
That's a great question, because research is really important. So for the first book, it actually wasn't too difficult because I already knew a lot about these women. So some of the women, I went back and reread their autobiographies, or I read other things that had been written about them, or I went back and read some of their speeches or interviews with them. I listened to some old interviews. But for the second book, I did have to do lots of research. And I'm really thankful that many of the women in the book do have organizations either kind of dedicated just to their legacies, or for example, Kate Sheppard, who was the kind of leading suffragette in New Zealand. There's a whole museum dedicated to women's suffrage in New Zealand, and there's a tremendous amount of kind of source material on her. So I did have to do lots of research for the second book, but thankfully there were very credible and reliable places to go to learn more about the women.
If I wanted to write a book, what would be your advice?
Start. I mean, I've found that like when I'm writing, whether I'm writing kind of something that's kind of more academic about global health, or I'm like working on my next children's book, I just make myself sit in front of my computer and I say to myself, like, I'm not gonna get up until I've written X number of words. And they may not be very good words, but the not very good words help me get to the better words. So I would say just start and then just keep persisting.
I'm 12, I walk home every day, and I get catcalled. What advice do you have to girls my age who this happens to?
What do you do now?
I usually try not to look at them when I walk by, but it bothers me really a lot.
I think the right answer is what's gonna make you feel good. And you may have to try some different things, right? You either can ensure you're always walking with someone, because we do know that girls are less likely to be catcalled and called out when they're walking in pairs or in threes than walking alone. That also probably would give you a real sense of security if you wanted to go and talk to them. You know you're not alone, to then go up and say, like, it's not okay. And then you know, like, if they do it again, at least you tried to tell them how it made you feel and why it's not okay. And I have found that when people say awful things to me in real life, which happens, I respond, and this is easier for me to say because you're 12 and I'm 38, and I've had a lot more practice of this than you have had, for better or worse. I always, like, start from a place of, like, this is not about me. Right, the catcalling, it's not about you. Right, it's about like their misguided sense or need to belittle you to make themselves feel better. Right, so it's not about you. So whatever you decide to do, whether you decide to just ignore them, kind of walk with a friend to see if that encourages them to stop, which it may well do, you decide to walk with a friend and then to confront them to say, it's like not okay and doesn't make me feel very good, or I'm sorry you feel the need to do that, that's often my approach. Like I'm really, like when people say like, I wish you would die today, I'm like, I'm really sorry that you feel that way and I hope you have a great day. And I mean it. Right? So the right answer for you is whatever the right answer is for you. But clearly the, like what's happening right now is not the right answer for you. So just try different things until you feel right and good, because you deserve to feel right and good. And don't let them make you feel badly, because that's what they're trying to do. And that's a really sad commentary on them. So you can either try to give a little bit of kindness back to them, or you can find a friend and ignore them and hope they'll stop.
Will you be writing another She Persisted book? And if you are, you can always reach out for me for those people. And as you said earlier, there are many women and girls that you don't, that many people don't know about, that you don't know about. And you said that you reach out to people. Maybe you should reach out to people that you don't know at all, like at the Clinton Foundation?
Well, it's hard for me to reach out to people I don't know at all. But I am very open to suggestions. So if you have them, I hope that you will give them to me. We are thinking about like more She Persisted books. I've had a few people tell me quite cheekily that I should now write She Persisted in Outer Space. So I've done She Persisted, kind of focused on American women, and She Persisted Around the World. Now we should kind of go into the galaxy. So I don't know what will happen, but I'm very open to suggestions if you think there are people that I should talk to, because that's the only way that I learn of new people to talk to. So thank you. Oh, go to one of the microphones with your hand up.
Do we have one in the middle?
In the middle.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for sharing your time and your words of wisdom. How could you suggest, or how could other teachers like Mrs. Mitchell and all of the hundreds of thousands of good teachers help young women to write their stories? It may not be anything world resounding, but if young women could learn how to tell their stories, then they could be more comfortable in doing so, and others could learn from that.
Well, I think Mrs. Mitchell's probably more qualified to answer that than I am as a teacher. I certainly think, though, we have a lot of research that shows that the earlier girls are expected to tell their stories, both kind of to learn how to write their stories and also to tell their stories, to talk about their stories, the more confident they are earlier in life and the more likely they are to sustain that confidence throughout life. We also know it's really important that teachers call on girls because we know that starting, depending on the subject, in fourth or fifth grade, teachers start calling on girls less, particularly in math and science. So I think that sends a pretty clear message that the girls' opinions or answers like just don't matter as much as the boys do. So I think it's both about kind of giving permission and having an expectation of girls to tell their stories. I also think it's about ensuring that girls are given the same chance just to engage in the class, like even beyond their stories, because I think that's an important thing that we all need to be aware of and working on too. We can come back to you.
Who Who is your role model?
Who is my role model? Well, I certainly look up to all of the women in these books, and as I shared in the first book, I've looked up to those women for a long time. But my role model is my mom. I mean, my role model is absolutely my mother. So I am, since it was just Mother's Day, I have been thinking a lot about how the best part of my life is now being my mom, my kid's mom, and how I wouldn't change any part of being my mother's daughter. I'm just so thankful that I'm lucky enough that she's my mom.
Hi, my name is Pam. I'm deaf. And I was wondering, have you written about Helen Keller in one of your books?
I do. I write about Helen Keller in my first book. And I'm really so thankful that Harriet Tubman and Helen Keller are the first two women in She Persisted. And I don't remember a time when I didn't know their stories. I remember my mom talking a lot about Harriet Tubman and Helen Keller when I was a little girl. And I'm also really thankful that there are kind of multiple now like enhanced audio versions of She Persisted, and National Braille Press just published a Braille version of She Persisted. So we're trying to do kind of whatever we can to ensure that the book is fully accessible.
There's two pages. On the second page, you had a couple of girls come up and read the second page. Did the people that did all the like work, did they really say that, or did you just think about them like that?
They really said those things, and I'm really thankful that clearly they all were not only kind of so inspiring in what they did, but also kind of in how they talked about what they did, because it made it easier for me as an author than to have really exceptional quotes to be able to put on the second page of the women's stories.
Why did you persist?
Why did I persist? I think persistence is hugely important in life. I think that what these women's stories say to me is that, you know, talent is clearly important, particularly if you want to be an Olympic athlete or a kind of prima ballerina. Talent is clearly important if you are going to win a Nobel Prize in any field, whether it's kind of physics or peace. But none of these women would have achieved anything without persistence, often over hurdles that I couldn't imagine. Right? I'm an incredibly like blessed and privileged person. Right? I'm blessed in that both my parents have always been really supportive of me. I'm blessed in that like I had good, strong relationships with my grandmothers while they were both alive. I'm blessed to have always had good friends. Some of my friends like from childhood are here today. And I'm really privileged, right? I mean, I always had a roof over my head. I always had food on the table. I never had to worry about that. I always went to really good schools. And so I think the persistence part is particularly important to me, because I think, you know, I'm often asked, particularly since the election, like, don't I just want to like put the covers over my head? I say, no. Like, what good does that do anyone? And I think about the women whose stories I share, and they persisted, and without their persistence, like, we wouldn't have had all of this discovery or kind of the transformation of what's been possible for women's rights and participation, or we wouldn't have had kind of this beauty and achievement in the world. Like, I'm not going to be an Olympic athlete. But I do think I have something to contribute, and so I am going to keep persisting because I think that is the only way to kind of honor my role model, my mom. I'm a deeply religious person. I feel like that's my calling. And as a mom, I feel like that's what I owe the future that I want for my children.
So we have time for one more question. And then for anyone who hasn't had a chance to ask your question now, you can ask Chelsea if you get your book signed. That's absolutely. So we've got one final question over there.
If you couldn't write about people who persisted, what would you write about?
Oh, if I couldn't, well, I'm lucky that I get to write about a lot of different things. I get to write a lot about health and access to health and healthcare or lack of it. I get to write about animals. I get to write about young people who are kind of doing remarkable things to stand up to bullies. So I'm lucky that I get to write about women who persist. I also get to write about a lot of other things, which I'm very thankful to do. And since I know that was the last question, I will also say I'm really thankful that I get to do it with Jill, because she's a great editor. Books are a team sport. So just a thank you to Jill and to everyone who lets me get to do what I love. So thank you all for being here.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you both so much for coming, and thank you both for sharing these amazing stories about these 13 remarkable women. What great life lessons for all the young people in our audience. I'm gonna ask our special guests, Chelsea and Jill, to exit the stage. If you all don't mind, give them another hand, please, as they walk off. And a few housekeeping notes, please, if you don't mind, while they are exiting. I'm going to ask you all to exit to the same doors you entered, those to your right. If you'd like to get in line for a book signing, our wonderful volunteers will help guide you in the right direction for that. And if you would like to purchase a book for Chelsea to sign, please visit the tables located in the foyer before getting in line. Thank you all again for coming, and enjoy the rest of your afternoon.